हेलो वेलकम एवरीवन इन दिस ट्यूटोरियल ऑन टॉपिक हैबिटेट एंड एडैप्टेशन। हैबिटेट एंड एडैप्टेशन, सो फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल व्हेन वी आर डीलिंग विद एनी चैप्टर व्हाई डू वी नीड दिस चैप्टर। हैव यू सीन द पोलर बियर? ऑब्वियसली नॉट इन रियल बट इन टीवी। द पोलर बियर लिव्स इन डीप आइस, सो द शेप ऑफ देयर बॉडी इज हैवी, its color is completely white, its body is capable of doing hibernation and a hell lot of things. Comparing it with camel, camel has long legs, long neck, has hump on his back where he can store fat, okay, and can live without water for many days. And can now camel and that polar bear, if I replace polar bear in desert and camel in pole snow, will they be able to survive? No, they both will die. Okay, they both will die. We can't leave the living thing from its habitat. We can't remove camel from desert and place it in on mountains. And similarly, we can't place polar bear from deep snow to deserts. They won't be able to survive. That is the thing which we are going to study in detail in this chapter. So, the first topic in the chapter is environment. So, what is the meaning of environment? The natural world. The natural world around us is our environment. Okay, so environment can be divided into two parts, biotic and abiotic. All of the natural things which are around us. Okay, so when we are talking about biotic, so when we are talking about living things, biotic means living things. We call it producers, consumers, scavengers, and decomposers. Okay, producers, which produce plants. All plants are capable of producing oxygen and food. All of us are consumers because we eat whatever plant produce, fruits, seeds, we eat it to survive. So we are consumers. Okay, now consumers can be carnivores or herbivores, it can vary, but basically we are consumers. So after consumers we have scavengers and decomposers. Scavengers, those depend on dead and decaying organisms. Scavengers and decomposers which depend on dead and decaying organisms. For example, if a plant died or a tree died, then bacteria or fungus will grow on it and it will convert it into humus, which is helpful for the soil. So scavengers and decomposers. But on the other part, we have abiotic components, which means those which are non-living components. So non-living components are light, air, temperature, water, soil. These all factors are very, very, very important for anyone to survive. Why I am saying this? Because suppose light. If I close this room with black color and I close this window, then not allow any light to come inside it, and I keep a nursery inside it, plants, a huge amount of plants, small baby plants, will they be able to grow? No, they will die because they need light. They need light to grow food, to live. Okay, so light is a factor. On polar regions, 6 months they have sunlight and 6 months they do not have sunlight. So that is the reason vegetation is nearly negligible vegetation, because 6 months they have the sun, other 6 months they do not have the sunlight on poles. Okay, so light is a very important factor. Then air. if a plant is kept near to a very polluted city, the plant will not be able to grow as compared to the plant which is kept in a remote area which is having zero pollution. Plant will grow very nicely, but the plant growth will be deteriorated here. So why this? Because of the air, because of the pollution and anything which is near to it, it will because plant is dependent on the air for food, so both things will be done. Okay. Similarly, organisms, other human beings, we can't live on high altitudes like on mountains. On the top of mountains, we can't live because the level of oxygen is very low. We need the level of oxygen to be quite high, so that's why we can survive normally on land. Okay. Also, we can't survive inside deep inside the earth because again the level of oxygen will decrease inside. Okay. So air is a very important factor. After air, temperature. Yes, temperature is the most important factor. Right now, temperature is quite low. It is quite not easy to survive inside this temperature. Okay, but when the temperature is normal, like for example the month of November, January, after January, February, March and October, November, when temperature is just 20 to 23 degrees Celsius, it's a very nice time to live. We don't get too much of sweat and we don't get too much of cold. Okay, so that is the reason temperature is a very important factor. Like for example, I told you camel have the habit of handling a 50 degree Celsius temperature, and polar bear has the capability to handle minus 50 degree Celsius temperature. If you change their places, they won't be able to survive. Water, obviously you can't allow ask a fish, you can't take a fish outside of water and ask, fish, can you live without water? Obviously she will die. Her gills will not be able to convert oxygen from the atmosphere. She need oxygen from the water. Okay, so water is a very important factor. Even humans are also dependent on water. Most of the civilizations in the past, you have heard about Harappa civilization, Indus Valley civilization, Mesopotamian civilization, they all arise or started on the shores of the rivers or very near to rivers. Okay, Indus Valley civilization is based on the complete Indus Valley, rivers. Mesopotamian was on the Nile River, and all are there. Egyptian civilization was on the Nile River. So all societies or civilizations, they all need water. Okay, people can't live in desert because desert do not have water. People can't live on mountains because at the top of mountains water is not there. We need to be on the ground where we can access water easily. Last is soil. Yes, soil matters. Like for example, you can't grow anything on desert and you can't grow anything in snow. You need soil to be perfectly fertile. Now, without fertile soil, if the soil is not fertile, you can't grow anything. And if you can't grow anything, what will you eat? Okay. So, if there are plants, animals will be. If there are huge amount of plants, animals will come near to it. Birds will come near to it. But if there are no plants, will ever animals or birds will come near to it? No, they will not. They will go away from that place because there is no food for them. Okay. So, light, air, temperature, water, soil, these all are very important factors for any environment. Okay. Now, after environment, the next topic is habitat. Habitat is natural environment where species can survive and produce young ones. Natural, like for example, polar bear can live in poles very easily. It's its natural habitat. Similarly, the natural habitat of camel is deserts. Natural habitat of fish is water. Now, water, it may depend. It can be freshwater fish, it can be marine water fish. So, it will depend. But it is water only which it needs. So, habitat, or I should say, the complete scenario of habitat is provided. And if that natural environment got disrupted or disrupted, the life of the animals also get destroyed. For example, if a forest is there, forest is a habitat for n number of animals, and if you destroy the forest, now there are no trees inside the forest, where will those animals go? They won't be able to survive. They will have to enter in the cities, or they won't be able to live much longer. Okay. So after having that, the next thing which we need to understand here is types of habitat. Okay, we already have a discussion that the place where animals survive and can live properly and produce number is habitat, where it can have shelter, food, and necessary things are available. It's that organism's habitat. Now, types of habitat. So, habitat are first type is terrestrial habitat. So, when we are dealing with terrestrial habitat, we are actually talking about forests. Okay, forests and land masses. So, when we are dealing with forests, so forests are generally described into three types, that is tropical rainforest, temperate rainforest, and boreal forest. So, one by one we go on each topic. So, first is tropical rainforest. Tropical rainforest means those forests which are very near to the equator, which are very near to the equator line. Here, temperature is quite high. Temperature is quite high. So, what are the features here? Tropical rainforests are found near the equator. They are also known as rainforest. The year-round high temperature and rainfall are ideal conditions of these rainforests. Many species of plants and animals live in the tropical rainforest. So, what is the major thing you should remember here is, dense growing trees create a thick canopy layer in the tropical rainforest that keeps the sun from reaching the soil. This means that the most animals that live in tropical forest adapt to living in or under these trees completely or partially. Moreover, when warm temperature and abundance of food, these forests create high competition among species. High competition. High competition means they have everything what is needed for any species to survive. So, all species fight with each other to take that landmass for themselves. Okay. So, tropical rainforest. Now, what are the adaptive features animals have obtained in these forests? Camouflage. Or blending their basically camouflage is they will stand there, but still you won't be able to recognize that something is there or not. That is camouflage. For example, chameleon, or there are multiple insects which exactly look like leaf. There are multiple insects which exactly look like leaves. So if they are there, you won't be able to even recognize them that if it is a leaf or an insect. Okay, so the camouflage, they have the color, they have the somewhat like shape where they mingle with the surrounding their surroundings. You can't even recognize or separate them. Oh, you can see this. Okay, so camouflage or blending in one's background helps both predators and prey to live in a place where competition is rampant. Animals such as chameleon and leaf insect blends with the surroundings to avoid predators. Predators means shikari. Choosing the perfect spot. Many animals choose a particular habitat or level in the rainforest to avoid competition for resources. The spider monkey lives in the topmost parts of the rainforest canopy where there is less number of species. Obviously, they are talking about a you can say monkey which lives at the very top of the trees. Okay, now because being at the top, no one is there to hunt it, and it is able to eat the food and everything what it needs. Type of bees. Toucans, they have adapted by developing long and large beaks that help them to crack hard nuts and dig them up the ground. Leaf cutters and carry bits of leaves and bury them underground. Later they eat the fungi that grows on these leaves. Conspicuous coloring. Contrary to camouflage, some insects and snakes develop bright coloring to distinctive marks to scare away predators. For example, look at the moth, or the, you can say the butterfly, which is there. Its shape, its design is in such a way that if a predator, see, it feels a lizard is watching it, it will think that it's a very big animal, I can't eat it. So it will just move on. So they have designed their colors or their body in a manner that they can scare other one off. Smaller size, rainforests are generally not suitable for larger animals since it causes hindrance in their environment, their movement. Among thick foliage, most animals found here are small and lightweight. Jaguars restrict their path to 6 feet that allows them to move and hunt with ease. Sloths and monkeys are excellent example of light body mass. They have to keep their body, for example, there are huge number of trees in this only small area. So they can't find a straight path to move on. They have to turn their body. So it's quite difficult for them to move inside such places. So they need to be very small. Okay. Slow movement and physiology. Sloth compared compound camouflage with very slow movements. They have very slow digestion and takes around a month to digest the food. They eat very slow. They are very slow. They are nani slow. They eat very slow. They move very slowly. Okay. They are very slow. So that is the reason predators are not able to understand that whether something is here or not, or it's just a plant or a tree which is just moving. Nocturnal habit. Now, nocturnal habit means those who are active in night. Hunting at night reduces competition for hunting for many animals like bats, bandicoots, etc. This also allows smaller animals to avoid predators because at night they are sleeping and they are hiding somewhere, so predators won't be able to check on them. Now, what about the trees? These are the adaptations that work, animals or birds. Now, what about trees? When we are talking about trees, waxy drip tape leaves. Leaves of tropical rainforest often have a waxy surface or waxy coating with pointed tips called drip tips at the end to enable excess of rainwater to run off, preventing the growth of algae. The algae would reduce the availability of the light to the plant and therefore its ability to photosynthesize. Suppose it is a leaf and a huge amount of water is stored here. Because of water, algae or some other bacteria, they will come over here and they will start living. And now if they are covering the complete leaf, so even they are not harming the leaf indirectly, but they are harming it indirectly as light will not be able to pass through it. And hence the leaf will die. So in order to protect themselves, what they do is they have a waxy coating from where nothing can stand there. Everything will be washed off. Leaf size. Leaves become longer at the plant as the plant rises to make the most of the increased sunlight. Because in the high canopy, those leaves which are at the lowest point, they are not able to receive the proper sunlight. So they need to be make some arrangements for it. Epiphytes. Due to dense vegetation in rainforest, very little sunlight is able to reach the ground. So to make the most of the sunlight in the canopy layer, some plants live on the surface of other plants, mostly tree trunks and branches. These are called epiphytes. Epiphytic plants are also called air plants. They don't grow on the soil. They grow on the branches or tips of the trees so that they can have the sunlight, which normally they are not able to have access when they are at the ground. Because canopy or the leaves on the trees are so dense that they do not allow light to pass through the them. Next is temperate rainforest. So, temperate rainforest means mild summer and winter forest. Temperate changing of the seasons in order to cope with cold winter and hot summers. Some specific adaptations to resilient temperate forest are hibernation. Hibernation, that is, they have a long sleep. Winter is the toughest challenge for the animals in temperate forest. By sleeping through the winter, animals cope with scarcity of food and fierce winter. These animals are eat voraciously during the other seasons and gain half their body weight. Some animals of these animals are raccoons, skunks, bear, and woodchuck. Migration. Many animals or birds prefer to do migration. Those who are not able to sleep or take a long sleep, they what they do is they migrate. Siberian crane, they migrate from Russia to India, and there are many birds who travel nearly 3,000 kilometers or even more than that. 3,000 kilometers is very less distance they cover. They cover a huge distance from one place to another for migration. Many birds and animals migrate to warmer places to avoid winters. All animals, including amphibians, fish, and other insects, migrate. Deer, elk, moose, bighorn sheep, and pronghorn are the some examples of mammals that migrate. Temperate forests have mostly deciduous trees. In the summer, their broad green leaves capture sunlight and help the trees make their food through photosynthesis. As temperature cools down in the autumn season, the chlorophyll breaks down, causing the beautiful red, yellow, and orange leaf color of the fall. Okay. In cold winter, it is too cold for the deciduous trees to protect their leaves from damage or freezing. So they simply lose them and seal up the places where the leaves attach to the branches. In spring seasons, they grow new leaves to restart the cycle. During spring season, they can again grow leaves. Now, next is boreal forest. The boreal forest, also known as taiga, is the largest land habitat on the planet. Boreal forests are characterized by long winters and short summers. Most precipitation is in the form of snow. Precipitation means rainfall, type of rainfall, you can say, whatever which is falling from the sky. It is in the form of snow. So it is always cold. It is always cold. So animals found near here are adapted for long and cold winters. They usually have thick fur. Some examples are deer, moose, elk, caribou, snowshoe hare, wolves, grizzly bear, lynxes, and wolverines. Other adaptive features such as camouflage are also shown by animals in this region. Adaptation for plants in boreal forest. Like animals, plants in boreal forest are also adapted for long frigid winters and short dry summers. They have mostly evergreen trees. The slender and conical shape of the many boreal forest trees help them to shed snow and protect them from damage. What actually happens is, they have teeth-like plants or trees. Generally, tree which we have here, they spend like this, they have leaves like this so that they can have the maximum amount of sunlight. But in boreal forest or in cold regions, the trees are like this, because whenever the snow is falling, it will just slide down. Because if snow, if the branch is like this and snow is getting accumulated here, because of the weight of the snow, branch may fall off, it may break. So in order to protect such things, they do not have such type of design. They have to design like a cone, where anything which is falling over here will fall automatically downstream. Next is grassland habitat. Grasslands are areas where tall trees in the forest, tall trees in the forest which don't need much rainfall. Which are without tall trees. In grassland, we are talking about grassland savanna, and there are multiple examples where trees are not there. trees are very limited, okay, but grasses are there which can be can go up to 6 or 7 feet high, okay. Long grasses are there, that's why they are known as grasses. They do not get water very easily as rain is very less, okay. In these regions rain is quite less, okay. So grassland habitat, when we are talking about grassland habitat, it is without trees, or I should say it is without tall trees. Some small high trees are still there, but the thing which is in the maximum amount are grasses. The grasses can be up to 6 feet high, okay. So the amount of trees is less because the rainfall is also very less. Grasslands are areas where tall trees are areas without tall trees in the forest which don't need much rainfall. These habitats receive more rain than desert but less than forest. Every continent except Antarctica has grasslands, but they have different names in different places. For example, in Africa they are called by the savannas and welds, pamps in South America, steppes in Europe and Asia, prairie grasslands in North America, rangelands in Australia. 1/4 of the earth is covered by grasslands. Some adaptations unique to the animals in the grasslands are speed. Animals, irrespective of being predator or prey, they do not have trees to hide behind. Yes, they do not have trees to hide behind, so they need to be excessively fast. For example, tiger and deer, they both live in grassland and they both have very high speed. They can run very fast because if the predator is fast, then prey should be faster to protect itself. Special digestive system. A lot of grazing animals inhibit this habitat due to abundance of grasses. These animals have strong incisors, front teeth and molar teeth on the gum for tearing and chewing the grass. They have special digestive system to digest the grass. Sharp sense of hearing and smell. Herbivores like deer have very sharp sense of smell and long ears to detect danger from quite long distance. Camouflage. The grassland animals, especially the predators, also have the skin color which can help them be camouflaged in the natural surroundings. For example, if you have seen lion or tiger, the skin color of their body is somewhat like which can be which help them in hiding in the grasses. Okay, they can't be easily seen inside the grasses. Or they can be only seen when they are standing and when they are about to just you can say attack. Some adaptations due to the plants in grasslands are follow. Due to very less rainfall, many grassland plants have small and narrow leaves that reduce water loss. Small leaves and small and narrow leaves, because of which water loss is extremely less. Grasslands are windy and dry, so to prevent from uprooting, these plants have strong roots and flexible stems. Like if wind is blowing on very high speed, so if a tree is there, tree will try to obstruct or it will fall off very far, very soon because of the speed of the you can say wind. But a grass, it do not have very strong stem, so what will happen? It will just simply bend. It will bend to protect itself. Next is also to absorb the water from the ground. The roots of plants in grassland grow deep into the soil. Now next is desert habitat. So desert are the place where I should say there is literally no rainfall. So places where there is no rainfall, animals and plants are adapted in a way that they can survive on very less amount of water. For example, many desert animals do not drink water at all. Dorcas lizard, desert lizard and kangaroo rats do not drink water even when it is present. Special diet. Camels and some other animals have special skin. All desert animals have thick, tough skin to prevent water loss. Camels also have thick eyelashes and nostrils that can help, that can open and close, thus protecting them during sandstorms. Their skin is so thick, like we sweat. Our skin is very thin, so that we can sweat and remove water and get cold. But the skin of the camel is quite, you can say, thick. Because of the thickness, water doesn't come out easily. Small size. Large animals are unable to survive in the desert as they are unable to find shelter from the sun. So the animals adapt to small sizes. Camels, however, are an exception because of their size. They are called the sheep of the desert. They can live without food and water for many days by utilizing the fat stored in their hump. A camel can live without water for approximately 18 to 20 days. But at the moment they get the water, they are able to drink nearly 20 gallons of water. Again, about animals, then what about plants? When we are dealing with plants, plants also show some definite. So, what plants do is, plants do not have leaves down there. They, like for example, cactus. Their stem is covered with green color, or you can say it has chlorophyll in the stem, so that they do not have to leave the water. And even their design in such a manner that during respiration or photosynthesis, in both situations, they do not let the water go out. Those pieces of plant that can survive in habitat with less water are called xerophytes. Some examples of xerophytes are cactus and pineapple. Some of the adaptations in plants living in desert are as follows. The plant has small leaves and spines to reduce the water loss. These plants store water in their fleshy leaves, stems or roots. Their leaves have thick waxy coating to retain water in them. The leaves of plants such as cactus are modified to store food. Then polar region and mountains. Polar region, the habitat where extreme cold and precipitation in the form of snowfall. Saving energy, most animals in this region like the manor, marmot and bear conserve energy during long harsh cold by hibernating. Hibernating means simply they go to sleep. Hibernating means they simply go to sleep. They sleep for a span of 3 to 5 months when they, where they are utilizing the fat which is already stored inside their body. Climbing rocks, mountain animals such as goats possess special hooves which helps them to climb. Yes, goats and the cows of the mountains, they are of quite small size and because of their special, you can say, shoes, they can climb or on a literally standing mountain, sloping a mountain also. Insulation, their body is covered with thick fur for, to protect their body against cold. Polar bear have thick layer of blubber and black skin below the thick white fur to help them conserve body heat. Psychological adaptations. Mountain yaks have larger lungs and heart which allows them to survive in high mountainous regions. Like I said that in mountains, the amount of air is quite low. So in order to protect themselves or have the maximum amount of air, they have large lungs. Plants such as pine and conifers are found in the mountain. They are conical in shape, allow snow to slide down easily. They have needle-like leaves and waxy coating to reduce loss of water. When you are talking about aquatic habitat, it can be divided into two parts. That is, freshwater and marine habitat. Freshwater habitat is different and marine habitat is different. Though both are inside, we are talking about water, but when we are dealing with them, freshwater means water without salt, and marine means a huge amount of salt or salty water. So, freshwater habitats are aquatic habitats that low levels of salt, almost less than 1%. They include river, lake, stream, pond, swamp, wetlands, bogs, and lagoons. Marine habitats are the ones with more salt concentration. They include oceans and seas. So, water is heavier than air with minimum temperature fluctuation. Hence, adaptations for this habitat is very different. Fish exhibit all classic adaptations required for aquatic habitat. So, basically, what happens is, I will tell you one thing. I was having an aquarium. In that aquarium, fishes were there. During the process of changing the water, I forgot to check the temperature. That temperature which I am taking out and the temperature of the water which I am filling inside should match identically, should be exactly equal. It was nearly 1 degree, not more than that, it was approximately 1 degree Celsius temperature difference. But that 1 degree Celsius temperature difference was sufficient to kill the fishes, because their bodies adapted to a fixed temperature, as water temperature doesn't change very fast, okay, like air. So what are the things they have here? Streamlined body means stream body, their body like this. So larger at their point and smaller at their this part, so this allows them to swim very easily inside water. Presence of fins, they have fins. These fins allow them to swim in water very easily. The fins help the fish and other aquatic animals like the shark to move in different directions. Dolphins and whales, even though are not fish, have their forelimbs modified to fin like flippers. Strong muscles. Fish have very strong V-shaped muscles in the body called myotomes that help them to move forward. Presence of gills. Fish, shark, prawn, lobsters, tadpoles and other aquatic animals have special respiratory organs called gills that allow them to breathe in water. Dolphins and sharks do not have gills. This is the reason they come up to the surface of water from time to time to breathe in the air. Dolphins, sharks and even whales. Whales also don't have this thing. So what actually happens here is, they have gills nearly here. So they take in the water. The gills are capable of removing oxygen which is inside the mixed inside the water, and hence they are able to survive. Sense organs. Fish develop a special later lines in the sense organs located in the head and along both sides of the body. It is used to detect movement and vibration in the surrounding water. Swim bladder. Sense organs means they have a special organ inside their head through which they can detect any movement inside water. Okay, like we need our eyes to check any movement, our ears to hear the movement. They can sense it without eyes and distance, because they do not have a proper ear. Swim bladder, a hollow and large sac filled with gas, is present in the abdominal cavity of the most bony fish. This helps the fish to change depth in the water. Air is inside the body, so they are able to dive in, and when they want, they can easily come out. Blubber. Just like polar bear, in the polar regions, whales have a thick layer of blubber under the skin to protect the body heat from cold and harsh temperatures. Aquatic plants need special adaptations for their survival in water or on its surface. Some adaptations are as, water plants have leaves and stems that are long, narrow and flexible to move with the water current. Stems and leaves are able to move with the water, so that's why they do not break easily. Some aquatic plants have air sacs in their stem, leaves and roots to help hold the plant up in the water. Inside the stem, they have water, special sacs where air is filled. Because of these sacs, they remain straight and always point outside. Some plants have leaves that float on the top of water, exposing themselves to the sunlight. In floating plants, chlorophyll is restricted to the the upper surface of leaves. The upper surface has a waxy coating to repel water. Like for example, the leaves of lotus you have seen, and on the leaves of the lotus, they are chlorophyll and everything. Water actually, gas actually is taken from the overside, and it is covered with a waxy coating. This coating does not allow water to stand on it. Whatever the water will come, it will just fresh off. Aquatic plants that are submerged lack strong water transport system in their stems. Dissolved gases, water, and nutrients are absorbed through the leaves directly from the water. Because they are already inside water, so they don't really have to be curious about having special organs to do that. The roots are poorly developed or absent because nutrients are already floating inside the water. Stomata are absent or localized on upper surface of the leaves if present. As I said, stomata, generally in all the leaves of a terrestrial plant, stomata is at the bottom side. But in aquatic, they are on the upper side. Those which have leaves are leaves are ribbon-like to avoid damage due to water currents. They are in the shape of ribbon to save themselves from water, speed of water. The body is covered with mucilage to prevent decay. Mucilage to prevent decay, yes. As I said, that their body is having a special capability that scales or mucilage are there on the body so that they do not get deteriorated because of water. If I keep my fingers inside water, it will start rotting up. My skin will show different patterns. That is the reason, because my finger is getting excess amount of water, which is not habitual to. But they are habitual to water, so they can show they can't show any such things. So they have a protective layer on their surface. Alien habitat. Now, as we have a discussion about aquatic, so alien habitat. So whatever is in the air, they should also have streamlined shape, because when they are flying, they need to follow this pattern. Broad from the start and small from the back, so that they can move very easily. Also, they have this round shape. So, streamlined body offers least resistance for birds and animals and other alien animals during the flight. Psychological adaptations. Birds have hollow bones. Additionally, they do have many parts without bones, like jaws bone and tail bone, which reduce body weight drastically. Their bones are very small, and most of the things, like we have teeth, so we have a huge number of teeth. So in order to remove their weight, they shed their teeth and their jaw bone and everything. They only have beaks, very small, small or large, whatever they, according to their needs. The presence of the light weight beaks instead of teeth help them to search and have their food easily. Wings. In birds, the forelimbs have been modified to become wings, the primary organ to flight. Feathers. Feathers of the wings and the tail help the birds to fly and maintain direction. Obviously, they need their wings and every tail to have the proper direction. Aerial habitat. Arboreal habitat. Arboreal habitat is the home of four organisms that live on trees. Arboreal habitat can vary from the banana trees in tropical rainforest to the white spruce of the Arctic. Arboreal adaptations are in many ways similar to the aerial, since in both habitats, animals need to defy gravity. Lightweight. We already had a discussion about lightweight. Then, limbs and tails. Arboreal animals have elongated limbs and that allow them to swing efficiently from branch to branch. Several creatures have long tails called prehensile tails that can grasp branches and act as an extra limb. Spider monkey, possums and chameleons are examples of animals that use their tails to help move and stabilize themselves in the tree canopy. Because they are living on the top of the tree and they don't bother to come on the ball, on the surface, so they use whatever they have to live there. Tails of them hang like a hand and help them to stick on the, you can say, prehensile thumbs. Monkeys have their thumb placed opposite to the other fingers, which gives them better grasp to hold onto branches. For example, our thumb is at this direction, so we can hold it things like this, but their thumb is exactly at this position, so they can have a better grip of the things. Okay, so this is the thing we are talking about. Adaptations and its types. Polar bear lives in the poles. We already had a discussion about this adaptations. Now we are talking about its types. Morphological adaptations. So when we are dealing with morphological adaptations, these are adaptations that involve changes in the structure of an organism. The structure of organism will vary. For example, a person living in broad desert or in Africa, they have long height. But a person living in mountainous regions like Himalayas or Alps, their height is small. Okay, so that is morphological adaptations. These are the adaptations that involve changes in the structure of an organism. An organism's environment sharpens its appearance through morphological adaptations. For example, desert foxes have large ears for heat radiations, and Arctic foxes have small ears to retain body heat. As another example, I have given you about the humans. Their height vary from place to place. Then physiological adaptation. Physiological adaptations are the one which make changes in the internal system of the body. These are generally undetected by external signs. Some examples of physiological adaptations include more efficient kidneys of desert animals like kangaroo rats, and that prevent water loss by urine. Komodo dragons survive with less food is also adaptation of its nature. Another example, snakes. Another example is snakes. Except Antarctica or colder regions, snakes are found literally everywhere. And the design and the body of the snakes from the inside, they whatever they eat, they need 30 to 40 days to digest it properly. Okay, so it is another type of adaptation to survive. Behavioral adaptation. As the name suggests, adaptations that affect how an organism acts and are behavioral adaptation. They are behavior we are talking about. These are conspicuous in nature and thus most common. Bears hibernate to escape cold. Birds and whales migrate to warmer winter climates. Desert animals are active at night during hot summer. Whether lizards seek a sunny spot in the morning to warm up to operating temperatures more quickly, and birds migrate to move from areas of low or decreasing resources to high areas of increasing resources. So these are behavioral adaptations. They change their behavior, they change their pattern. For example, you have already studied that there are some animals which hide in the night. During their day, they are active, and there are multiple which are nocturnal. What they do? They become active at night and hide in the day. For example, owl. Owl has capacity to view things in day also. They say that owl can't see things in the day, but they can see things very clearly in the day. But in night, they can see it 20 times better than day. Okay, and they can hear things very easily, so that's why they are able to grab the predator very grab their prey very nicely and very easily. They can catch it